How much of civilization is shaped by our biology? How might our cities, transportation, and technology look different if we weren't a group of nearly hairless primates? The video game Spore has the answers. Okay, well, maybe not the answers, but Spore does offer an interesting case study into the fundamentals of how a speculative lifeform might build a society. In our first Spore episode, we followed a lifeform from a microscopic organism to the intelligent Curiousus Sapiens. In this episode, we'll witness the ascent of their civilization, and explore how the unique biology of an alien like Curiousus Sapiens would affect things like the design of clothing, the schematics of vehicles, and the shapes of buildings in unexpected ways. We'll begin with tribal stage and go all the way to space, completing the multi-billion year tale of Curiousus Sapiens. So, let's return to Planet Curious, and discover the finale of the story of life. After the early evolutionary stages, the birth of society is underway, with Curiousus Sapiens building fires in early lodgings. But is this the dawn of a wise people, or a culture of warmongering tyrants? What path will Curiousus Sapiens take in shaping the destiny of their planet? Like the game's biology, cultural evolution in Spore is fairly simplified and exaggerated. Tribal stage seems to be a mesh of various eras, but seems most comparable to a hunter-gatherer culture. At this point in history, Curiousus Sapiens appear to only have access to simple technologies, quite similar to that of early humans. It might seem surprising that Curiousus Sapiens would converge on concepts like pottery, but there is some precedent for this idea. On Earth, certain technologies are cultural universals, meaning that numerous cultures invented a version of them independently from one another. The sheer number of times disparate populations have invented something like pottery indicates that when intelligent minds are faced with the same problem, similar answers might emerge. Whether or not this would hold true for an alien in an alien environment is difficult to say. But depending on the circumstances, Curiousus Sapiens inventing pottery is certainly possible. As technology improves, Spore gives us the option to determine the clothing of Curiousus Sapiens. The question of what kind of clothes an emerging sapient alien species would wear, assuming they'd wear clothing at all, is actually a tricky one. Clothing is so ubiquitous today for us Homo sapiens that we almost don't think about it. The initial invention of clothing was likely tied to climate, and served as a way to protect our hairless bodies from the elements. Yet compared to Earth, Planet Curious, like most planets in Spore, seems to have an extremely temperate macroclimate, so it's unlikely clothing would develop from temperature control alone. Yet clothing can also protect the body from specific environmental hazards, like pests, abrasive substances, and other irritants. So, it's possible that protective attire would first emerge in Curiousus Sapiens in particularly vulnerable areas, like the base of their eye stalks. Human clothing also has various social functions across cultures, and some articles of alien clothing could serve in these ways. Unlike humans, Curiousus Sapiens have an elaborate display structure sprouting from their shoulders, similar to the extravagant plumages of certain birds. It's not too big a leap to assume garments would be built around complementing these structures, making them appear fuller and more impressive. An emergent hunter-gatherer species would also likely find value in various satchels or pouches to carry resources. And finally, aliens might develop some articles of clothing with no apparent function whatsoever, either as reflections of cultural trends or expressions of personal style. In the case of Curiousus Sapiens, clothing choices would be limited by available materials, which in this age would likely comprise hides, grass, leaves, and shells. The end result is attire that certainly looks pretty strange to our eyes, but a Curiousus Sapiens would likely find the eccentricities of our clothing just as puzzling. As time passes, Curiousus Sapiens fall into a rhythm within the hunter-gatherer lifestyle, with obtaining food the most important task during this era. Historically, permanent settlements on Earth rarely emerge until after the invention of agriculture and domesticated plants. Spore skips over any mention of agriculture, but realistically we can assume that Curiousus Sapiens have some early version of subsistence farming figured out. And Curiousus Sapiens aren't the only life forms to have achieved advanced intelligence. Across planet Curious, other species are building their own societies. Different unrelated species reaching the same level of technological advancement during the exact same period isn't particularly likely. But this is how Spore functions. The question is, how will Curiousus Sapiens choose to interact with their new neighbors going forwards? To guide Curiousus Sapiens through this new era, two tools are now available for construction. The spear and the wooden horn, which looks like a kind of rudimentary flute. As far as early tools go, these are actually fairly plausible. Spears are the oldest weapon we have an unambiguous archaeological record of, dating back to the Paleolithic age. Likewise, mammoth bone flutes from the Paleolithic are the oldest known musical instruments. Realistically, however, the tools of a species like Curiousus sapiens would likely be different from our own. It's interesting to deliberate on whether a lifeform like Curiousus sapiens would develop a spear in the first place. Humans lack the claws and fangs of most top predators in the animal kingdom. Pressuring early humans to invent tools to compete with the natural weaponry of other animals. Yet an unarmed Curiousus sapiens is already a formidable customer, and might not need to be as creative. Still, it's possible that any emergent tool user would be able to puzzle out the basic concept that sticking something sharp on the end of something long is a good way to deal damage while keeping yourself out of harm's reach. In either case, with their new tools, Curiousus sapiens can now enchant other species with their musical instruments, or impale them on the end of their spear. As thinking social omnivores, Curiousus sapiens make allies when they can, but when another species attacks first, Curiousus sapiens respond in kind. In a trend that sadly echoes our own history, this early era is marked by frequent conflict. But society is also changing in other ways. Curiousus sapiens are on the path towards creating a larger and more stable civilization, a path laden with new developments. At this point, Curiousus sapiens gain the ability to domesticate animals, a crucial trait for emergent civilizations. There's a lot that could be said about animal domestication, but to simplify, we humans began our animal domestication journey with wolves before the agricultural revolution. Then moved on to small herbivores like sheep and goats once we began staying in one place for longer. Beasts of burden that could plow fields or give you a ride like cows and horses came later. Curiousus sapiens will begin their journey with this small, bird-like quadruped, harvesting their feathers for clothing and construction materials and their eggs for dietary consumption. Generations later, the second animal Curiousus sapiens domesticate is this large, horrifying spider beast. These hardy giants might look intimidating, but they're actually quite docile, and will fill the role of plow animals. It's worth noting that while once again Spore never touches on agriculture, in order for this sort of domestication to be possible, Curiousus sapiens must have begun the practice. And with these animals in their corner, the population can grow to new sizes, and society itself can become more complex. New buildings are now available, like this outlet for fishing spears, seemingly implying the emergence of small industries and the increased specialization of tasks within Curiousus sapiens society. And just looking at their society, culture seems richer and more diverse, with different Curiousus sapiens sharing ideas and playing musical instruments. After making one final alliance, Spore gives us the option to advance to the next stage. Hurtling forwards in time, civilization stage begins with the option to build a modern building. Once again, Spore's timeline of historical change is certainly a simplified one, as there are, historically, numerous steps between small subsistence societies and an emergent industrial civilization. Likewise, Spore puts no limits on this first building, letting you construct something truly absurd if you feel like it. Fun as that can be, it's interesting to consider what an early industrial house might look like for Curiousus sapiens. Unlike humans, Curiousus sapiens are nest builders, and have been for the past several hundred million years of their evolution. As a result, it's possible that their instincts for houses would be different from our own, building smaller, more low-to-the-ground dwellings that evoke their ancestral nests. With a town hall constructed, the Curiousus sapiens debate the nature of their society. With a stable food supply, natural resources like spice, which flows from most planets and spore, becomes the new valued commodity. The value of spice and spore reminds me of the sci-fi world Dune, and if my memory of that series is accurate, a reliance on spice might cause problems. But for now, Curiousus sapiens are a young populace with their heads lost in the dream of the future. On that note, Spore gives us the option to design our first vehicle that will help with transporting the spice. As always, Spore lets you design whatever absurd thing you want, but alien cars genuinely might not look like what we'd expect. Certain things like wheels could be universal considering the constraints of physics. Yet our vehicles reflect us more than we realize. Several studies have shown that when we look at most cars, our brain's facial recognition cortex is activated. This isn't a coincidence. Cars are designed to subtly resemble human faces to appeal to our pattern-seeking minds. And if Curiousus sapiens have similar instincts, it's likely their vehicles would subtly reflect the geometry of their faces. With the first vehicle constructed, the spice can be gathered and transported, for better or worse. In this era, other civilizations of Curiousus sapiens have also emerged. We've already seen this species, much like humans, has the potential for war and cooperation, so the ultimate future of Planet Curious will be determined by how well they can work together. Contacting our closest neighbors, we can offer gifts, compliment them, or say their people are descended from limbless space slugs. Now, I'm no political expert, but I suspect one of the first two options is a better tactic. Thanks to such savvy political acumen, the two civilizations establish a trade route and begin the long road towards a united future. As time passes, cities become larger and full of new technologies. Thanks to the steady force of negotiation, alliances form, first with immediate neighbors and then with more distant countries. As technology improves, clothing evolves as well, featuring new textiles and construction materials. I tried to make the post-industrial clothes of Curiousus sapiens still vaguely echo earlier cultural trends. Got to keep those silly hats, after all. In time, we unlock the secrets of motorized flying machines and can design our first air vehicles. Here, the constraints of things like wind resistance might shape our craft into something similar to the planes we have on Earth. Although just like with their land vehicles, Curiousus sapiens may build something that subtly reflects the geometry of their faces. And with their natural stalk eyes and more flexible necks, Curiousus sapiens likely have a greater visual field than humans. So the cockpits of their aircrafts might have more windows to the sides and back. With aircrafts now soaring through the atmosphere, the planet is more connected through trade than ever before. Achieving planetary peace through careful management and negotiation is admittedly not the most exciting, but it's certainly worth it. At the end of this era, Curiousus sapiens are united under one banner, and looking towards the stars as their next horizon. And so, the final chapter, Space Stage, begins. Curiousus sapiens are no longer beholden to just a single meager world. After designing a spacecraft that follows the same aesthetic standards of other vehicles, for the first time, Curiousus sapiens are free to explore beyond the protective atmosphere of their home. Traveling to another planet in the system, the sapiens discover a crash vessel, and are lucky enough to scan and replicate its interstellar drive. From the perspective of the player, you can now zoom out and behold the entire galaxy, spinning just like how it is in the title screen, except you can now go to any part of it you like. That first moment when you realize the whole galaxy is now yours to explore is pretty magical, and makes the scope of Spore feel so impossibly vast. The galaxy is waiting, and the rest is up to you. Every one of these stars contains their own system of orbiting planets, which you can fly down to and visit, At the time when Spore first came out, this kind of procedurally generated universe was something never really attempted before. At the same time, such scale has its drawbacks. It's hard not to feel like, in a galaxy this large, nothing you do has much meaning. I know a lot of people's least favorite stage is space stage, and I understand why. It's easy to become disconnected from the creature you started with billions of years ago. Although perhaps that's an unavoidable symptom of a species becoming a galaxy-spanning civilization. Expanding across the cosmos, Curiousus Sapiens gained the ability to build self-assembling colonies on barren worlds. In their expansion, they search for radio wave frequencies that might signal the presence of technologically advanced life like themselves. On our planet, we're scanning the stars for alien life by searching for similar frequencies, although with our limited range, so far, we've found nothing but silence. Yet Curiousus Sapiens can journey much further out across the stars, and eventually they encounter other intelligent, spacefaring life, who rose from the primordial soup just like they did. In time, Curiousus Sapiens even unlock the secrets of life, and can create creatures to populate newly terraformed worlds. This kind of power can be used to create bizarre forms of life, as biology becomes an infinite playground. In the words of science fiction author Arthur C. Clarke, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic, and that adage holds true here. It can also be used more responsibly, and we'd have to hope that such an advanced form of life would be sensible with their power. Looking forwards, Curiousus Sapiens will ascend to a civilization we can't fathom, transcending technology beyond the scope of our limited minds. By design, Spore skips over many of the stages of history, condensing and exaggerating the long road of technological advancement. Yet the game does explore a surprising number of the universal principles of how civilizations and technology change over time. I know not everybody likes the later stages of Spore compared to Cell and Creature, and I can understand that. Still, the novelty of guiding a speculative creature through their technological advancement is still pretty intriguing even all these years later. Like I said in part 1, I'd love to see another high-profile game tackle something similar, as I feel there's real potential for a modern take on this concept. As always, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support to help make videos like this possible by liking, subscribing, and hitting the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.